First Thessalonians, chapter 4. First Thessalonians, chapter 4. Does anyone know what the point of church is?
Worship the Lord.
Mark already went through this a little bit, but yeah, now we can worship. Yeah, what else? Come on, why are you here? Because of these comfy green seats. Oh, there's just so... I just come here on Sundays because there's no seats like this in all the land for my bottom. Right? No. What's the reason you come? Gavin's got a nice plush, black, cushiony. Whoa, you've got a cushiony one too. What the heck? Green, cushiony. John's got a plush one too.
Someone's colorblind.
Jeez. We know why you guys come to church.
Yeah, we got the cushiony ones.
They come early. Why do you come?
They slide off. To be encouraged.
To be encouraged. Ooh. Come on, that's a good one, reason. Yeah. I wrote this down ages ago and I found it. I'm like, I gotta read this. If you are in church this morning, I believe God has drawn you here by His grace. That He wants to equip you. Now, what does equip mean? Equip means to give you something, to give you a tool, to give you an impartation, to teach you something that you didn't know before. God wants to equip you. He wants to teach you. He wants to mold you. What does that mean?
He wants to have His way.
Make you new.
Yeah, mold. Oops. Sorry, guys. Mold means to change your life. Do your legs change? No, you don't. You don't like change.
I love change.
You love change? You love change. You love the results of change. But I don't know if you like the process. You know, church isn't always meant to make you happy. Even like worship. I've been in many worship services and I'm just like in conviction because everyone else is like dancing and getting blasted and I'm like, oh, the Lord's dealing with me.
Yeah.
And that's a powerful church service. And I don't feel any joy. I don't feel any presence of God. All I feel is the dealing, the discipline of my Father, changing me, molding me, transforming me. Have you ever been there before?
Yeah.
And you think like, oh, I don't know if I belong to this church because I didn't feel the presence this morning. Well, maybe God is dealing with you. You know, the Bible says that the Lord disciplines us so that we may be partakers of His holiness.
Yeah.
So that we may mature and grow into what He has for us. So just because you didn't feel the presence, or just because you didn't get goosebumps, doesn't mean God is working mightily in you. Because sometimes the process of Him molding you is painful, not pleasurable. Sometimes the process of Him changing you is painful. It's not always pleasurable. So God brings you to church. He gets you. He draws you by His grace, so that He may mold you. You know what? I believe He wants to bend you, shape you. I believe sometimes the Lord wants to break you in a good way.
Amen.
Break you of your own will. Break you of sometimes your own desires. Amen.
Amen.
Come on.
It's like, I thought we were singing about the love. We are singing about the love. This is the love.
Amen.
You know what? I've heard many, this is like an old like Christian kind of cliche saying, but it's absolutely true. God loves you just the way you are, but He loves you too much to leave you the way you are.
Right.
Did you know that?
Amen.
So God welcomes you in as you are, and He says, I love you! But He says, I love you too much to leave you the way you are.
Oh, right.
So I've brought you here to challenge you, to change you, to equip you, to mold you, to bend you, to break you sometimes. Because your will is interfering with what I want to do in your life. Your will. Some of us have said, not my will be done, but your will is interfering with God. So he brings you to a church like this so that he can start to bend your will and start to shape you, and so he might even, if you allow him, he might even be able to break your will and replace it with his power. You know what it's called? Following Jesus. It's just, Jesus said, no man can follow me unless he first denies himself, number one, takes up his cross and follows me. Then, my wife would attest, I'm not perfect at this. I got up this morning, I didn't even want to go to church. Pastor Josh, what do you mean? Yeah. I'm not going to divulge all the circumstance. It's none of your business, but I just want to go. We didn't sleep. I slept in Davina's bed all night. Not because Carly and Davina got up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I want to go into your bed. And Carly goes, go sleep in her bed with her. So me being the loving husband I am, crawl into Davina's bed, and I say, Daddy's you snuggle with Daddy. She goes, no, I want monkey. So she gets her monkey, she snuggles with monkey, I'm in her bed. This is a little, tiny little bed. Carly's in the king size with Austin. Exactly. I'm in the little bed. You know what that's called?
Love.
It's love. Yeah, it's called. Not my will, Lord. But your will be done. In Jesus' name. So I was a little grumpy. I didn't get much sleep.
I just kept saying that. Not my will, but your will.
And then Carly and I thought, I didn't want to go to church. I almost said to Carly, I'm like, I'm not going this morning. I was inside, like I was playing the man on the outside, but inside, I was having a temper tantrum. Inside. You ever did that before? Sometimes your little temper tantrum wins, doesn't it? And you don't go, and then you're like, and then the rest of your week is crap.
Amen.
Because you didn't get what you were supposed to get. Because Sunday is like, so you know what Sunday reminds me of? Sunday is like day one of creation. God said, let there be light. You know, on day four, God created the sun and the moon and the stars. So what was the light God created? Well, light is the foundation of creation.
That's right.
It's not natural light, it's physical light. It's the essence of everything that God was going to create. He was building on the foundation of his light. Day one, he said, let there be light. Then he made the earth and the skies and the heavens, and he separated the waters and everything. And day four, he said, let there be the sun and the moon and all the stars and the luminescence. But church is like day one, right in the morning, we're saying, God, over my week, let there be light.
Amen.
But what about the darkness that I like? Doesn't matter. Let there be light. What about my sin? Well, there's lots of churches you can go to and live in sin.
Yeah.
Do you know that? There's lots of churches in town you can go to. I'll give you some names.
It's true.
But here, you're going to get challenged. We're going to actually read the Bible, maybe, today. Holy Ghost. I'm going with the Holy Ghost. I just got to go with the Holy Ghost. Oh, Holy Ghost. Some of you, for me, I had to say this morning, I had a shower and I'm mumbling under my breath. I know, I go in the shower, like I go in the bathroom, slam the door shut. I didn't slam it, I could. I tried to slam it, but the stupid carpet got me.
Don't you hate that?
He's like, I need it in there. Grab a towel. Getting ready. Grab my stuff. Get to church. Signs aren't out.
No.
I'm like, James, where's Ed? I'm like, I'm in the little... Ed's the sign guy. I'm like, not feeling it at all. I don't want to worship. I feel no Holy Ghost. I feel no motivation. I don't even want to be here.
Cool. Thanks for coming.
Yeah.
But you know what? It's not about what I want. Yeah. Have you gotten that yet?
Thanks for being honest.
You can't follow Jesus if you stay your own boss. You can't follow Jesus if you stay your own master. Following Jesus means making him Lord, meaning that means master. Jesus becomes master of your life. In other words, you just come into line with creation, with divine ordinance, with God himself. Your own way doesn't work. It would have sucked. Could you imagine if I didn't come to church this morning? I thought about it. It was worse than usual. Sometimes I like, you know, I have a little resistance. I'm like, in Jesus' name, I'm pushing through. I do my confessions. I get downstairs. I worship a little. Spend some time in the Word. Get my coffee. You know? But no, I woke up beside Davina, kicking me. Daddy, I want to watch Dora.
She's so
I have to go pee. Okay, I'll take you. No! I do it myself. Okay, go. Jeez. You are your mother's daughter. He wants to break you, to mold it. Why? So he can empower you, so he can infuse you with his grace and his power. I've been doing this long enough to know that if I just step out, God will step in.
That's right.
There's been so many times in my life, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times, when I didn't feel like doing it, but because I knew it was God, I just stepped out, and the power of God steps in. That's a good word maybe for this week. Step out and let God step in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's for somebody today, right now. You got to step out and let God step in.
Let Jesus take the wheel.
Step out and let God step in. I actually don't really like that song because I think he's more of the passenger in your life. He wants you to learn how to drive. Sometimes he'll take the wheel, don't get me wrong, but he wants you to learn how to have self-control. 1 Thessalonians 4. I was going to read it, but I want to encourage you. Finally, then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and please God, just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. So I have a word for you. You're pleasing God with your life. God wants to encourage you to do it more and more. Please him more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. This is the will of God, your sanctification. Another version says, this is the will of God, your holiness. That you abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of you knows how to control his own body in holiness and honor, not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. That no one transgress and wrong his brother in this matter, because the Lord is an avenger in all these things, as we told you beforehand and solemnly warned you. For God has not called us for impurity, but in holiness. Therefore, whoever disregards this, disregards not man, but God, who gives his Holy Spirit to you. Now, concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. For that indeed is what you are doing to all the brothers throughout Macedonia. We urge you, brothers, to do this more and more, and you aspire to live quietly, to mind your own business, to mind your own affairs, and to work with your hands. This is the commandment of the Lord, to work with your hands. Get a J-O-B.
But I don't like to work in fast food.
Well, I guess you don't like $11 an hour either. No, people are like, I don't have a job. Well, get a job like in McDonald's or something. I don't like that job. Well, I don't know what to say to you then. You gotta start somewhere.
Right.
Start somewhere! But I don't want to. Well, come to church and let God break your will a little bit more.
Yeah.
That's where I used to work. Not bad. I worked at Dino's Pizza.
Oh, yeah.
That's a good job, actually, making pizzas.
It is.
Hallelujah.
Easy.
Work with your hands, as we instructed you, so that you may walk properly before outsiders and be dependent on no one. That's God's will, actually. That you would be dependent on no one, but that you would be self-sufficient with His power in you. Some of you are like, that is hard. I don't like it. Well, just let it get into you. Bend it. Let the Lord bend you. This is what I really want to read. But wait, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, those who are dying, for that you may not grieve as others who have no hope. For since we believe that the Lord Jesus died again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with Him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with a voice of an archangel, with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Isn't that good news? What are you saying? Jesus is coming again? Yeah, He's coming again. With the shout of the archangel, the command, the cry of the command of God, He will come in the clouds, and all who are dead will rise. Yeah, I'm going to see my grandma again? You're going to see your grandma again. Unless she wasn't a believer.
Yeah.
Ooh.
The believers will rise in Christ. And there was going to be a celebration. Actually, some will mourn because they realize I've wasted my life. But some will celebrate because they realize I've given my life to Jesus. Even some Christians will weep and mourn and gnash their teeth. They'll be in heaven, but they'll weep for a moment because they'll realize, I missed my calling. I missed my calling.
Amen.
So, I wanted to make a declaration today. I read this yesterday and I'm like, my goodness, I got to read this to our church and then we're going to close because we're out of time. But these are decisions that define us. We have decided that teaching the gospel without demonstrating the gospel is not enough. Good preaching, good doctrine, and being good people is not enough. Did you know that? People aren't going to come to Jesus because we're nice to them. They're going to come to Jesus because the power of the Holy Spirit arrests their heart. There was lots of people who were nice to me as a young person. But it wasn't until the Holy Spirit arrested me. The Holy Spirit spoke to me. The Holy Spirit got a hold of my life. And so we pray to this end. Why do we contend on Thursday nights from 7 to 8? Why do we pray in the mornings? Why do we contend so that the Holy Spirit will grow His church? It's the Holy Ghost that does it. Amen? It's the power of God. John Timberly, it's the power of the Holy Spirit that's going to raise you up this year like never before. We have decided that having a good church club is not enough. Good fellowship is not enough. And just being a member of that club is not enough. We've decided that having good Bible studies is good, but it's not good enough. That just making it to heaven is not our goal. And that knowing about God without truly knowing and experiencing God is meaningless. It's meaningless. Form without power. Paul says in 2 Timothy 3, he says, beware of people. They have a form of godliness, They look like Christians, but they deny the power of God. Mm-hmm. You know what that word power is? It's dunamis. Yeah. Miracles, healings, power, prophecy, tongues, gifts of the Spirit. Yeah. This is what church is. You read the book of Acts, there's been 2,017 years of charismatic Christianity. The church in the Bible is a charismatic, Pentecostal, fire of God church. There's only one church. Yeah. That is the church. Yeah. What about the Baptist? That's fine. I don't know about anything else. You call yourself whatever you want to call yourself. The Bible church is the church of power. Yeah. It's a church of authority. Yeah. It's a church of miracles. Yeah. It's a church of passion. Yeah. It's a church of people who are saying, not my will, but your will be done. What does that look like? We talked a few weeks ago. It looks like whatever. It's just following Jesus. We've decided that gifting without character is futile. We've decided that singing songs without worshiping is shallow, and having meetings without God showing up is pointless. Yeah. We've decided that having faith without works is not enough, and having works without love is not acceptable. That our function comes from our relationship first with the Father and second with each other. We've decided that reading about the book of Acts without living the book of Acts is unthinkable. Come on, 2017, where are the warriors at? Where are those who are going to fast and pray? Where are those who are going to deny their flesh and let their spirit man rise up big in them? We're going to be starting a fast this month, the 21-day Daniel fast. We're deciding a day, we'll let you know what day it is next week. But we're thinking the 16th, Monday the 16th, 21 days, fasting and praying, contending for God to move in our lives, in our families, in our cities. God, we don't want to let our flesh overtake us. We want to let our spirit overtake us. We decide that hearing about the Holy Spirit without experiencing Him is silly. That being in His presence without seeing it manifested in signs and wonders is hypocrisy. That believing in healing without seeing people healed is absurd. And that believing in deliverance without people being delivered is absolutely ridiculous.
Wow.
We have decided to be Holy Spirit filled, Holy Spirit led, and Holy Spirit empowered. Anything less doesn't work for us. We've decided to be the ones telling the stories of God's power, not the ones hearing about them. Who wants to be the one? Shakarama Sunday. Who wants to be the one telling the stories? This is what God Almighty has done in our lives. This is what He did in my marriage. This is what He did in my family. This is what He did in my body. This is how He healed my mind. This is how He raised me up. Not my will, but Your will be done. We've decided that living saved but not supernatural is living below our privilege and short of what Christ died for. Right. We've decided that we are a battleship, not a cruise ship. Mm-hmm. An army, not an audience. Special forces, not spectators. Missionaries, not club members. Amen. It's hard, I know. You're in the battle. That's why it's called a battle. It's a war. And you're in it. We have decided to value both pioneers and settlers. Pioneers to expand our territory, and settlers to build on those territories. But we are not squatters. People who take up space others have fought for without improving it.
Amen.
That's a good perk. We've decided to be infectious instead of innocuous. Contagious instead of quarantined. Deadly instead of benign. Deadly to the enemy.
Amen.
We've decided to be radical lovers and outrageous givers. We've decided that it is better to fail while reaching for the impossible that God has planned for us than succeed settling for less.
That's right.
Did you get me? It's better to fail reaching for the impossible God has ordained for us than succeed in settling for less. We've decided that nothing short of His kingdom come, His will be done in our world as it is in heaven, will satisfy. We've decided that we will not be satisfied until our world freaks out and cries out, those who have turned the world upside down have come here too. Have you read that in the book of Acts? That's what they did in the book of Acts. They turned their world upside down. Now, if we can get 100 people in this city turning the world upside down, the city's gonna get shaken. People might get upset. Oh, yes, they will. They will.
That's all right.
That's all right.
That's okay. Jesus gets happy.
Yes.
And we live for Jesus.
That's what's happening.
Not people's faces.
Emojis.
We gotta finish. We've decided that we are on a mission, that we are a mission station and not a museum. Therefore, we will honor the past, we won't live in it. We will live in the present with our eyes on the future. We will see past events, successes and failures, as stepping stones, not stop signs. We will pursue learning in order to be transformed, not learning in order to know. We are a people of engagement, not observation. We focus on what could be, not on what is or what has been. We are not limited to the four walls of this building. Our influence is not restricted by location. Not even the nations are out of bounds. Not even the nations are out of bounds.
Right.
We are more concerned about how many we send out into the world than about how many we convince to come into this building. This building is meant to be filled, and it will be, but it will not be the measure of who we are or the measure of our effectiveness. We raise up world changers, not tour guides. We train commandos, not committees.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit says, Son, I'm raising you up to be a commando in this generation. I'm raising you up to be a commando in your generation. And even right now, I'm training you, says the Spirit of God. And I know it's hard, says the Lord, but I'm raising you up. Taking every bit of shame away from you, and I'm burning it all up in the fire, says the God, so that you may be pure gold, and that your faith may be more precious than the finest of gold,
yeah,
says the Spirit of God.
Come on.
We are people of our destiny, not of our history. These decisions are not destinations, but rather journeys along the ancient path. We have not found some new way, but rather rediscovered the path of as old as of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The same path followed by Moses, Joshua, and Caleb, Paul, John, and Peter. The path followed by the first century church, a church that revolutionized the culture of the first century and beyond. It is a path that will impact the world we live in. It is a path of bold faith, believing that what God says is really true and acting on it. It is a path of outrageous generosity, giving our life away in order to demonstrate His kingdom. It is a path of radical love, loving God with everything in us and our neighbor as ourselves. It is a path of liberty, freedom, and healing. On this path, you find significance, purpose, and destiny. This is a path less traveled. However, it is not a path only available to a select few, but to whosoever may come. That's good news. It's for you. It's for me. It is for people of every nation, tribe, and tongue, for those in any occupation or vocation, no matter where you are in your life journey, there is room on this path for you.
Amen.
I'm telling you, Jesus has a plan for you, for me, and He has a plan for this church. I was talking to Mark the other day, and I was encouraging him, and encouraging me. I said, Mark, we just need to get the word every day. How do I keep my sword sharp? How do I keep my mind focused? How do I stay in the realm of the supernatural? Even if it's for 10 minutes, I need to open my Bible and just keep on reaching this Bible. What if my flesh doesn't want to? Kill the flesh.
Amen.
Kill the flesh. Not literally, I'm not telling you to stab yourself. I'm saying put down your flesh and pick up the sword of the Spirit. Huh. Get in the Word of God. Let Him transform you. Can you enjoy that? This is a year of liberty and power and destiny for you. Do you know where it's going to come from? The Bible. I can't preach enough. I can preach right now until I'm blue in the face, spit all over you, and you won't get it. You need to go into this word yourself and go deep. And don't worry if you don't understand. Holy Spirit will teach you day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year. He will teach you this word. God is raising you up. He wants to raise you up in a mighty way. Your personality and, it's just so awesome what God does, isn't it? Okay, I'm going over time.
That's okay.
For some of us, it's okay. We are just like, wants to give their life to Jesus afresh this morning. It's Jesus. Put your hands up. Is there anyone here that like, I haven't given my life to Jesus before, but I want to? Just quickly wave at me. I want to give my life to Jesus this morning. Just give my life to Jesus. What does that mean now? Just make him Lord. Follow him. Worship him. Experience it. You guys are good? Okay. Stand to your feet. Let's pray. Just, if you can, just grab your neighbor's hand. If you can. Grab your neighbor's hand. Grab your neighbor's hand. I remember one time we were in a prayer service and they said, grab hands, and I grabbed hand with the dude next to me and we interlocked fingers. And I'm just like, I didn't realize what was going on. Something's wrong with this right now. And I'm like, oh, shit. Just a big sweaty dude, right? Interlocked fingers with this guy. I'm like, oh, shoot. And I grab it like normal. Dude, grab it. Dude. So if you interlock, you don't need to do that. Don't interlock fingers with me. So. Holy Spirit.
What if we want to?
Then, well, no. You're not allowed in this church. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing and what you're saying. And Lord, I pray this word would go deep this morning. And Lord, that everyone under the sound of my voice would receive it. And even though some of those who would watch it again and again to receive it even more on a deeper level. Holy Spirit, I just thank you for what you have for us this week. Lord, I thank you for what you have for this year. But I thank you for what you have for us this week. And Lord, that you're calling us to go out into the harvest field and plant seed and water and see it increase. Even this week for the glory of God. Amen. All right, you are free to go. I abound with blessing in Christ Jesus. And stuff like that. I'm a tither, and so I claim the blessing of the Lord. God, your word says that you will open the floodgates of heaven and pour out to me such a blessing that I will not have room to contain it. See, and if you keep doing that, I know something about this church. As long as I continue as the pastor, as the lead pastor, as long as I continue to keep preaching the word every Sunday, people will grow. Stuff will happen. No matter, not gauged on how I feel, not gauged on how I'm doing, not gauged on how I'm feeling, not gauged on how my relationship with Mark is, or my wife, or my parents, or whatever. That doesn't really matter compared to that we just continue to preach, we continue to sow God's word. And I believe that this missing element was as you continue to make a good confession, not just over your finances, but over your family, over your school, over your mind. I have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
And I am not impacted by demonic thoughts. They just roll off me like, you know, water off a duck's back, whatever. God will give you that confession. I believe as you say that and speak that over your life, stuff will begin to break. Amen. I really, truly believe this is the missing element to many of your lives. The Lord gave you a prophetic dream in all of this that we're saying. So just take your offering. Is this my offering? No, it's not my offering. Where's my offering? Can I have my offering? I want my offering. Hold on, Dana. Grandma. I'll take Grandma's too. All right. For my grandma, she's like giving it to me. $20,000. Oh, that's not. It's not 20,000. Just stand up with me for a minute. Stand up. Take your offering in your hand. We don't always do this, but maybe we should, but
yes.
We used to always do it.
We used to do it more. Yes, take your offering in your hand. Just say this to me. This morning as I give. I confess. I'm believing for. Jobs are better jobs. Raises and bonuses. Sales and and commissions,
estates
and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, unexpected money, debts paid off, debts demolished, debts destroyed. I am blessed and I am overcoming in my finances. In Jesus' name, I receive the blessing of the Lord. I confess the seed I sow into the kingdom of God will produce a hundredfold blessing or more. In Jesus' name. Okay, amen. Come up and sow your seed. We're praying for our own building. But I know the way that God is going to do that is by blessing the socks off of you so that you can increase in your finances so that you are able to do even more.
Amen.
But who knows, it's very challenging to be faithful with a lot when you're not first faithful with little. So we're determined to be faithful with the little that we do have. Oh, where do we want to go? I need to just... Who here is aware of the story of the widow's mite? Anyone ever heard that story before? The story of the widow's mite. So, Jesus tells a story in the scripture. We're not going to go there, but Jesus tells a story in scriptures. And Jesus is literally there, like in real time, Jesus is there at the temple and he's looking at the offering basket. And he's kind of monitoring what people are putting in. So all the rich guys, and he's looking. I mean, this is like against the rules, okay? Could you imagine if I'm like, each person, I'm like, hey, how much are you giving? Okay, how much are you giving? How much are you giving? People would be like, dude, like, what are you doing? Back off, that's between me and the Lord. But apparently, Jesus like thinks he's important or something. And so he's like monitoring what they're putting in. And he's like, hey, this guy puts 200 in, and Jesus knows, well, he's got 50,000 in the bank, but he puts 200 in, okay, all right. This guy puts 500 in, but well, he's got a million in the bank, so actually that other guy's 200 is more than his 500. Sometimes we're like, 500, but we don't realize the guy's got millions.
Yeah.
Then we're like, 200, but we don't realize the guy's got, you know, 1,000. But he's monitoring them all, and then this poor widow comes, and she's dirt poor, like homeless. She's got nothing. And she has one little, they called it a mite. And I don't know, James, how much was a mite? Probably a couple bucks or something.
About half a cent.
No, but it was more than that. It was more than half a cent. It was probably $100 or $50 or something. It wasn't much, okay? Maybe $10. I don't know what it was, but it was little. And it was all she had. And she put her mite. And you can see all the other guys just kind of like, wow, she put a little mite in. Oh, thank you, widow. Jesus looks at his disciples and says, I tell you the truth. She has put more to the kingdom of God than the rest of these. Because she put all that she had. Now, that message is not saying empty your bank accounts. That's not the point. The point is, Jesus wants your whole life. He wants your whole heart. He wants your whole being. He wants your whole mind. And you know what he wants? He wants your obedience. To give to him what he asks of you. Amen. Sometimes that's very challenging because we're like, we have fear and we have these issues and we don't trust God. But as we step out and as we radically trust him, he promises to radically take care of us. Isn't that awesome? I love that. Okay. Hallelujah.